The show with me, Alexis Conran, here on Talk Radio, powered by The Times. Know your times. We're going to continue our conversation a little bit longer about the Attorney General's independence. We heard earlier from Lord Charlie Falconer, who is concerned not about Suella Braverman's qualifications to be Attorney General, but what she feels about and her thoughts on the justices, the judges, the judiciary, and their roles. She calls them unaccountable and unelectable, and that is the whole point of judges. They are there on merit to do an impartial job. Now, David Kurten joins me, Brexit Alliance member for the London Assembly. Welcome to the show, David.
Hello.
Do you share Suella Braverman's views that the judges are basically biased, they're unaccountable, unelectable, and they're actually encroaching on the political authority of the executive?
Well, look, what I'd say is it depends on the judge, and there are a lot of good judges, but the judges are not elected in the same way that MPs are elected into the parliament.
And do you think they should be?
Well, no, they shouldn't be elected, but they should be accountable in some way. And I think there has been quite a lot of mission creep over the last 10, 20 years in particular, where the sort of the decisions which are political, which should be made in Parliament, have been taken over by some of the judges. And I think the judges are now trying to impinge on the political process and on democracy. And that's not a good thing.
Okay. Can you explain to me how judges are stifling a democracy by upholding the law of the land?
Well, one of the major cases in question, which a lot of people were concerned about, was the decision that the Supreme Court made last year, last autumn, on the prorogation of Parliament. And that is a procession in Parliament. That is something that is totally in the purview of Parliament. But then the Supreme Court, which, by the way, is a creation of Tony Blair, it's a very recent creation in terms of history, but they decided to overrule.
But are you saying, just so I understand, because it was a creation of Tony Blair, you're saying that it's biased. Is that what you're hinting at?
I'm not saying that, there's a wider issue about the Tony Blair administration and the sort of upheaval that they made to the whole settlement and the whole constitution.
But you realise that by what you're saying now, you're sort of casting and perpetuating this what I am going to call a conspiracy theory, because I believe it's verging on that these judges are somehow conspiring to thwart the government. I mean, the rules and the law is that you can't just shut down Parliament for not a good enough reason. It was a prolonged prorogation, one without precedent, I think, since back in the 1930s. The reasons given were not acceptable by law, and the Supreme Court just passed its judgment saying it was unlawful. I really don't understand where you have issue with that. I mean, I would have thought that
that was what the decision of the Supreme Court. That's what they decided.
They didn't decide it. No, they didn't decide it. I'm going to have to correct you. They didn't decide it.
You did ask me a question.
I did ask you a question, but I cannot allow you to change the subject. If we both speak, then no one. Okay, if we both speak, then no one actually can hear us. So they didn't decide the outcome. They applied the law. So what part of that do you have a problem with?
Well, let me actually answer the question, the original question, which was about, you know, what sort of issues do I have with the judges actually overruling Parliament. That was always considered, prorogation was always considered a process of Parliament, which in the Act of Settlement, which goes back to 1688, 1689, which we've always followed, that then is totally in the purview of Parliament. It is not for the Supreme Court to overrule a prorogation. That particular prorogation that happens every year at that time, there's always a prorogation for the party conference season. The way he did it, maybe some people agree with it, didn't agree with it, I don't know, that's up to individual people to decide. But the fact is that it's a process in Parliament. It is not the job or the role of the Supreme Court to overrule it, but that's what they did. And now that's on the statute book, that the Supreme Court has elevated itself above Parliament in a way that it shouldn't have done, which it has never done before. So this is something new that has overturned 330 years of settlement from the Act of Settlement of 1688. That is unprecedented. Mm. And so that is a case where they have assumed new powers to themselves.
No, I disagree with you there. They did not assume.
You're allowed to disagree.
I know I am. I didn't assume new powers. They applied the law. But let's just move on, because you and I are not going to agree on that. Do you think it is a good idea to move towards what Suella Braverman is hinting at, that these judges will be appointed by politicians? Do you think in the long term it is a good idea to have a judiciary that is somehow appointed politically rather than on merit of doing their job properly?
Personally, I'm not sure about that particular aspect of it. I mean, this is where I come back to, you know, taking issue with Tony Blair and what he did in setting up the Supreme Court, because they're already, in a way, politically appointed. I don't want to move to the situation where we're like the United States of America, where they have 11 Supreme Court judges and they are appointed wholly by the president, you know, so they can, whoever's in charge can put in their own person. I do think they need to be impartial, and they shouldn't be politicized. And my point in mentioning Tony Blair earlier was that we've already got a situation where the politicization of the judiciary has already happened. I would want to turn that back so that they are completely impartial. But going back to Suella Braverman, one thing that I do agree with her on is the whole mission creep of the Human Rights Act. Because what that does is it means that the judiciary is forced to make decisions which comply with the judgments of the European Court of Human Rights. So again, that's something else that supersedes what happens in this country and the independence of the judiciary in this country to follow our tradition of common law. And so on that issue, I do agree with Suella Braverman.
Mm. Remind me again, who helped draft the Declaration of Human Rights for the European Court?
Well, it was the British judiciary, okay. And they did a very, very good job back in 1951. And that was needed because Europe was reeling after the effects of Nazism. And, of course, we were the only country that didn't come under the Nazi occupation and were not destroyed. So at that time, we needed it. But since 1951, then you've got nearly 60 years of case law, which sometimes, you know, the teleology of that can contradict the spirit of the original, the thrust of the European Convention on Human Rights. Nothing wrong with human rights and the original convention, but what you have now is lots and lots of case law, which sometimes can contradict our own laws in ways which have unintended consequences.
Okay. Thank you very much for your time. That's David Kurten there, Brexit Alliance London Assembly member. I can't help but feel that it's due to the outcome of the decision that the attitude towards the judiciary has changed. We never really had that conversation before, but because certain decisions didn't go the government's way, all of a sudden, well, we need to look at these judges. They said that Parliament needed to have a say before triggering Article 50. Well, that's not on. They said that the prorogation of Parliament was unlawful. Well, that's not on. I'm not a lawyer, but I think if you don't have a trust in the independence of your judiciary, then you are in a lot of trouble.